Hi, I'm Carla Bruni with the Chicago Bungalow Association, and this is our How-To Home series. Today we'll be looking at energy assessments, and energy assessment is the first step to discovering what it will take to make your home more energy efficient and comfortable. We'll be following John Meehan from DNR Construction around to learn the ins and outs of what it entails to do a thorough energy assessment.
My name's John. I'm from DNR Construction. We're a family-owned company out of Oak Forest, Illinois. And we have 75 full-time employees. I'm one of them, and I do energy assessments. First thing I want to do is I want to talk with the homeowner, you know, make them feel comfortable, have them tell me if there's any issues with the house, such as where they feel uncomfortable, if they feel any drafts. And then the next thing I want to do is a visual inspection.
Okay, and is that a visual inspection outside or inside?
So we're gonna do both. I'm gonna go around the outside. I wanna make sure there's not any noticeable leaks, no roof leaks. And then when I come inside, the first place I wanna start is upstairs in the attic area, and kinda see how the insulation is up there. And then I'm able to gauge, you know, basically what this house is looking like insulation-wise.
Great. All right. Well, once all that's set, what is the first thing that you actually do to start testing?
So after I do that, I'm going to put the house in winter conditions so that I can do this blower door test. What I mean by winter conditions is basically all the windows closed to outside, all the doors to outside closed. But then I want all the interior rooms open to this test so it takes it all into effect. This is a blower door I already set up. And basically what it's going to do is it's going to suck the air out of the house, put the house under negative pressure, and then there's a manometer attached to it, which is basically a little computer that tells me how leaky your house is. Air leakage is what I'm talking about here, not water leakage. And I already did a calculation on this house. If this house was built today, you'd want it to be closer to 1,500 cubic feet per minute of airflow. And like I said, we're at 4,200. So we're almost three times leakier than a new house would be.
So the goal then is to try and get as close to that number of 1,500 as we can.
Exactly. I'm going to try to lower that number as much as I can. And the way I'm going to do that is through air sealing and insulating your house properly so that I can tighten up your house so you don't have this constant airflow of, you know, heat coming in and out of your house. Because what happens is the heat leaves, your house has to replace that air so it pulls on cold air, and your furnace or your boiler is running all the time to keep this house warm, and the result is really high bills and the house not being energy efficient. So the next thing we're gonna do is go upstairs, and I'm gonna show you some of the areas that we need to address to try to seal this house up better.
So now we're upstairs in the attic doing the next portion of the assessment. We came up here, and John, you explained that it was a really good thing that they already had a hatch. We just removed a door on this. Oftentimes there's not a hatch built in on a finished attic, so they have to actually cut a hole in here to see what's back there. Now, what is so important about seeing behind this wall?
So this is a knee wall here, and basically you have an attic area behind here. First of all, I want to see what's in there, see if there's any insulation at all, see if these walls were ever insulated, if the floors were insulated.
Because every house is different upstairs in an attic, so we do a lot of vintage homes, I know.
For sure.
Like a Chicago bungalow, for example, would have an overhanging eave, a portion that extends beyond the main part of the house. So that would probably be treated differently.
For sure, yeah.
Other vintage homes would do. So.
Definitely, and so in this case, there's barely any insulation under the floor. We also wanna see what type of insulation's in there. Make sure there's no vermiculite, which is an asbestos type insulation. And then in this case, now that I know what's back here, I'm able to determine what I need to do to insulate it properly and to seal it up better. Basically what I want to do is insulate these walls, and then I want to insulate the floors below and above the floorboards. You don't want to just put insulation above a floorboard because then you're leaving a gap. You want it to be touching where the heat stops, which is at the ceiling below, and then it also stops right here.
Great. Well, now that we know what goes on back here and why it's so important, let's go on to the next part of the assessment. And now we're back in the living room. Now that we have completed the assessment work in the attic, what do you look at in the walls of the main part of the house?
It's a good question, Carla. We definitely want to look at the walls of the house to see if we could possibly insulate the walls better. In this case, this is a brick house. So what we want to do is we want to use a liquid type foam to fill the gap between the wall and the brick. You got to be careful what type of insulation you use on a brick house. So in this case, what I would do is drill three holes, one at the top, one in the middle, and one at the bottom. And I inject a liquid foam in there, and then I patch it all up when I'm done.
Okay. And does the homeowner paint that then?
The homeowner's got to paint.
Okay.
after we're done. We patch it up and everything. It'll be ready to be painted though.
Okay. Is there a difference when you're doing an assessment on a brick home versus a frame home?
Definitely. So these brick houses, a lot of times they have about approximately a 1-inch gap between the wall and the brick. But in a frame home, you a lot of times have a larger cavity. It's about 4 inches, a 4-inch gap perhaps. And in that case, we'd use a different material. We use cellulose insulation and we dense pack the wall cavity. With high pressure hoses, we fill each cavity of the frame wall.
Is there a reason you have to do this from the inside, or could you do that from the outside as well?
The phenolic foam we do from the inside, the liquid foam, just because of the brick on the outside. But for a frame house, we could do it from the outside if it doesn't have any asbestos-like shingles. But a lot of these vintage homes have asbestos-type shingles underneath the siding.
Right, and a lot of them don't have any insulation.
That's true. A lot of them aren't insulated at all.
All right, great. Well, let's move on to the next step of the assessment then. So, John, we talked a little bit about insulation already. How can you tell if a wall has already been insulated? Is there kind of a way to cheat so you don't have to tear the walls apart out of the gate?
Yes, there is. So what we use a lot is an infrared camera for a number of different reasons. One is it helps us to identify if there's been any insulation put in the wall. It's going to tell us temperature differences too, which helps us to see basically how the differences in temperature between the outer walls and the inner walls. We could also use this after we do the work to see if there was any deficiencies in the insulation.
So we've talked a lot about how to make your home tighter and keep a lot more of that airflow out of your home. But John, isn't there also an issue with there being a lot of, you know, harmful gases that our mechanical equipment produce in our home? And is that something we should be worried about?
For sure, definitely. That's a big part of the assessment is doing a health and safety test on all this stuff. Also known as like a CAS test, which is combustion appliance zone testing. Basically what I'm doing is I put the house in a scenario where everything's pulling away from the furnace and the water heater to make sure that in that case, everything's still drafting out.
So worst case scenario.
Worst case scenario, meaning all your fans are running, your dryer's on, the air handler's on, and we're pulling away from these appliances. But at the same time, I gotta make sure that these appliances are still venting out because it's not safe if they're not. So what I do is I use this instrument called a testo. It basically will turn the furnace on. I'll measure the carbon monoxide levels. So it'll tell me how much carbon monoxide it's producing. It'll tell me how much it's drafting out, which is important because I wanna make sure that this stuff's really drafting out well. It's also gonna tell me the efficiency of the furnace. And then I can print this out so that I have a record of testing this stuff. Also, I can inform my guys if there's something they need to do. Perhaps they need to pitch the flue better to make it draft better, or put a larger flue in so that it drafts out better. I do that test on both the water heater and the furnace. I'm making sure that this house is super safe. It's great to tighten a house and insulate a house, but at the same time, we really want to make sure it's safe.
Well, we also get to follow you around for the next installment of the How To Home series. And see you do all of this work with your crew. So I'm pretty excited about that. We're looking forward to seeing you guys next time. And thank you again, John.
Great, looking forward to it.